Thank you. Can you hear me? Is the microphone on? Okay, now that I have been thoroughly embarrassed, squashed, flat into two dimensions.
If you sit down, they can adjust the, the speakers from...
Unfortunately, I can't stand for 1 hour, so if you don't mind, I'll sit down. So, like this.
And they'll adjust the...
Yeah. Like this, I hope. Yeah, now that I have been squashed definitely the two dimensions. I'm trying to talk about, we'll try to talk about three dimensions. I've been threatened with sudden death if I am overloading the meeting, the presentation. There's so much I have to say and I have to cut it down. My good friend Herman visited me in the hospital a few weeks ago and he said, you know, don't you overload it. Professor Bluth threatened me as late as this afternoon not to overload it. In full panic, I eliminated still 20 slides. And in the hope that all this, which is really a cross-section through a book, The Seventh Continent, the Industrialization and Settlement of the Moon, on which I've worked through the last 10 years approximately. So it's this is coming out early next year here anyway in this country. So maybe I just touch on the tips of the iceberg and on the basic philosophy and the basic strategy with a few data that kind of underpin some of the things that I'm saying. And let me... Oh, I also hope, Mike, that those 12, 13, 14 minutes or 15 minutes that went on embarrassing me, they don't come out of my budget, do they? because I need every second. in the 60s, when the discussions unfolded and in part very emotional and very... in part very hostile to the space program, about the importance of going into space, specifically the importance of the Apollo program going to the moon, and statements such as 1 square inch on Earth is more important than a square mile on moon or Mars. And of course, all of us who were in space at that time and who understood the long-term meaning of space, not as a Roman circus between wealthy nations, not as excesses of ideological races between the United States and the Soviet Union, realized that we want to go out into space precisely because that 1 square inch on Earth is so very important. That the greatest ally that the space engineer, that the environmentalist has, is the space engineer in the long run. Because we are showing the road to a new open world. And in an open world, we don't have to destroy the elements of a world that has taken on the characteristics of a closed world in the way we as human beings operate. And the way we as human beings operate, I call it information metabolism, is a type of metabolism, if you will, a type of evolutionary development in which the brain does what in the biotechnical sphere the body or the bodies do, from plant to animal to human being. We are taking information, we decompose it kind of through abstraction and through generalizations and through discovering the laws of nature into its basic components. And then we rebuild it back up in a form that is storable in our brains and that is storable in the machines that we design, the intelligence machines. This is not perhaps the only form of intelligence on this planet. I personally happen to believe that a porpoise, a dolphin, has intelligence. Certain whales have intelligence, elephant. Many animals have intelligence, but they have not the information metabolism. If the if the porpoise would have information metabolism, he wouldn't be continue to be kept caught in nets of the tuna fishes. In other words, the capability of abstraction, the capability of metabolizing information. Now that is a new type of interacting with the environment between living forms, interacting with the inorganic environment, that for the first time is a major advance over photosynthesis. So may I, okay, let's have the first slide. You see, in the first Earth formation, in the light of the young sun, there was no control over the by anybody over the generation of inorganic matter. Earth was like a gigantic flower, which soaked up solar energy and also utilized other energy to establish basic organic compounds and amino acids. And when life began to stir here, they lived off those fossil acids, Haldane's famous soup that ate itself up, or something similar to that. And of course, eventually, the resources ran out. And the first great crisis of life on this planet occurred because they were living off previously generated organic substances and eventually of each other, the heterotrophs, heterotrophic cells of the autotrophic cells, so to say the forerunners of the plant-eating animals, the heterotrophs and the animals, and the plants, the autotrophs. It was then that we saw for the first time two things, that what seemed to be an absolute limit to growth was no limit to growth. It was an hindrance that had to be overcome and was overcome by technological advances, incredible technological advances, namely photosynthesis. And secondly, that life, if it has to, and a certain metabolism, if it has to have endurance, have to stay over long periods of time, cannot rely on the results of the preceding sphere, of the preceding generation of materials. And so we cannot rely on fossil fuels forever, obviously. That's a very analog situation. We have to start going to the primordial energy resources, which are so abundantly all around us and in the atom. And the technological advance occurred by the generation of an enzyme in the photoautotroph, which ultimately, I make it very short here, led to the chlorophyll molecule. And the chlorophyll molecule and photosynthesis inaugurated the first industrial revolution on this planet. And this industrial revolution already did what we are doing now too, namely it realized that it cannot be totally planetogenic. It has to go to space resources. It went to the solar resource, since it couldn't go out. Biological technology is not lend itself to go out into space, so it took that kind of resource that came to Earth, namely solar radiation. And solar radiation became the fourth element, so to say, of the new environment of life. Land, water, and water, land and air, and of course radiation. And with the photosynthesis, life created control or generated control over the basic staples of life. And it created it out of primordial materials, CO2, water, and with the aid of solar radiation, changed the solar radiation to chemical energy. And there was created the basis on which everything else relied, including the parasitic oxygen metabolism, which replenishes the only primordial resource in short supply, namely CO2. So what, and in the womb of what was created here then, namely the highly negentropic biosphere, an immensely complex system of ecological niches that built up to encompass an entire planet and industrialize it and process its energy and its materials. In the womb of this biosphere arose then the human being as the seat of the next higher metabolism. Now, each sphere, each large environmental sphere, which here took on planetary proportions, while here it had subplanetary proportions, has to have one umbilical metabolism. I call it umbilical metabolism because it is that kind of metabolism that interacts between the negentropic sphere and the entropic wilderness on the outside. And of course, here it was photosynthesis that did this. Oxygen metabolism is not an umbilical metabolism. It is parasitic, it eats other animals, and it consumes plants. And animals and humans, being in this respect the same, rely on the umbilical metabolism of photosynthesis and some other fermentation metabolism, such as nitrogen fixation. But the primary one is photosynthesis. Now, in that respect, the human being is not so much the descendants of the ape or proto-ape. The human being is actually the descendant of photosynthesis, because information metabolism is the first metabolism that actually can interact with the inorganic matter, and therefore is an umbilical metabolism, and is broader even than the photosynthesis, because we can interact with nuclear matter, we can build a chemical industry of vast proportions, although chemosynthesis has done that too. We will, in the next century, I'm sure, build up an atomic industry of enormous proportions, and a subatomic industry, and a quark industry. And so this goes far beyond that. And for this and some other reasons, information metabolism transcends planetary limitations and is the metabolism on which life moves now over into space itself. Now, I called the total evolutionary philosophy that began with photosynthesis and showed that already 3 billion or 4 billion years ago, life had to reach out for an extraterrestrial source and resource, the extraterrestrial imperative. And it has four basic components. The necessity of an open world. For physical reasons, you cannot have a motor running in a closed environment. You cannot have the machines of life running in a closed environment. You have to have an open world. The environmental niches of the first Earth, the biosphere of the second Earth, and now the endosphere of the third Earth. And just as the biosphere is controlled by the chlorophyll molecule and photosynthesis, so the endosphere is in a sense integrated and controlled by the human brain and information metabolism. But there is one big difference between these two. The biosphere is integrated and non-modularized. That means everything moves through everything. And that is necessary for biotechnology to work. The substances move through the water, through the land, through the air. That does not sit very well with information metabolic technology, for example, nuclear technology, chemical, information metabolic chemical technology. While the biospheric technology uses some 20 or 25 elements and recirculates them, because that's the only way in which materially they can keep an open world, because they cannot go anywhere else and get resources. The endospheric, or rather the information metabolic technology, is using the entire periodic system of elements, and then some more, and digs far below the periodic system of elements. That you cannot recycle on one planet. You have to go out. And you also cannot recycle it through all ecological or environmental zones of that particular sphere, like here in water, air, and land. The endosphere is integrated, but it is modularized. And that's exactly what we need for the human, that means information metabolic technology. What happens on the moon, or what happens on Mars, or what happens in any orbit, does not necessarily affect Earth. On the moon, we can build up a selenosphere, specifically. We have trouble with the geosphere because it interferes with the biosphere. And that's where the conflict lies in many areas. In the selenosphere, we have already a modularized situation. where the large habitats are separated by vacuum from nuclear power plants, from industrial plants, etc. And what goes on there does not automatically drift into the habitats. So this kind of modularization, which begins with the selenosphere and also has forerunners, for example, in the space station, and so is very important. It is, in fact, going out of or beyond the Earth, which is highly biophile, into the environments which are highly technophile, such as the lunar environment, such as orbital environments. We are adapting the new environment to the requirements of the information metabolic endospheric technology. The technospheric evolution of life is very clearly in these main steps, as I have already explained. This sociospheric evolution has two analogs in the biosphere. These are the species, and in the androsphere, these are the civilizations. The ways in which we are no longer different. We are no longer distinguishing each other as something different than human. If we have different color or different other things, but our civilizations differ. We have different approaches to different things. Well, anybody who lives in this world today knows that absolutely. But civilization is more. Civilization is the ascendancy beyond brutality. It is the recognition of plurality, the recognition that there are various ways in which to live, in which to explore nature, although the natural laws and so forth should be recognized by all because they are there, and if we disobey them at our own peril. But civilizations will continue to be formed because they are dependent on infrastructural elements such as location, conditions, etc. And if we look, for example, to a population on the moon or later on to a population on Mars, they will be different from us. And I come back to this in a moment. And so those three factors taken together assure continuing growth. As long as we have an open world, as long as we are not shying away from overcoming the problems that we have by technology and by our own development. I want to emphasize this very, very much. Technology is not the solution to our own shortcomings. We have to grow, we have to mature. But technology often can make it easier. If you have a no-growth philosophy, and if you regress into the Middle Ages, then you create an environment in which that, what you are asking the human being to do, namely to live with less and be very modest and being this and that, the other thing, and not to grow, is impossible. Because a dog-eat-dog fight is bound to break out under those conditions. We've come too far. We have to go on. And life shows us that technological advances are the road to go. But based on those technology advances have to come the advances of the species and the advances of our civilization. And if we do this, then we can proceed. Now, applied to space, that was my conclusion then at the end of the 1960s. There are three logical steps. One is we've got to have, and this leaves out, although I should say it, it's tacitly in here, of course, exploration. Exploration is the necessary first step. But beyond that, industrialization, the capability to live productively in the new environment, to underwrite the civilization. You can't go out with people first and then say, what the heck am I going to do now? You have to have a productive base that underwrites the civilizatory base. Civilization goes always together with urbanization. So exo-industrialization or space industrialization, exo-urbanization followed by this, the ability for larger numbers of people to live in the new environment and the change through the new environment. In this case, the change away from Earth. And the extraterrestrialization, can you read this? I will read it. The extraterrestrialization is the change of the human being through the different conditions in the new environment. I want to tell you that this is especially close to me because I have the experience of, so to say, extra-Europeanization. I was European educated, educated in the classics, educated in the belief that Europe is the mother of all modern civilization, it's the mother of Renaissance. Europe had its own style, it had its own philosophy, it had its own belief in itself, which was then shattered by two world wars, but it had that belief, and it still has much of it. And then I came to the United States, and my wife and I had to learn to a different environment, to a different history, to a different set of people that once emigrated from Europe and constituted a particular type of entrepreneur, of adventurer, of seekers for new frontiers and new revolutions, and so forth, which was not so prevalent in old Europe. And then we saw our children grow up, becoming far more Americanized, and now we see our grandchildren coming up, totally Americanized. So there is this changeover. And of course, if you imagine that one day large populations live on the moon, that will be even more so the case, because first of all, we have a different, we have 1/6G, we have all sorts of other conditions there, so there will be physiological changes. Then there will no doubt be immunological changes. Earth teems with life. It teems with all sorts of things. We will have a immunological checkout, an immunological Ellis Island on the moon, I am sure. Not everybody with tuberculosis and who coughs and sneezes and this and that will probably be allowed in the main habitats. There may be guest habitats, which again in the modularized endosphere can be full of bacteria that do not otherwise exist. The people who live on the moon directly may have to go through immunological changes, socio-economical changes. You see, on Earth, the biosphere was here first. We are a creature that was born, that was evolved with a biological silver spoon in his mouth. He behaved accordingly, devastated and everything, and Mother Nature, as we used to say, is cleaning up after us, like the maid in the very rich house. And there, here, the human being is there first, and the biosphere is there second. That will change very many value perceptions. Aesthetic and behavioral divergence and psychological and cultural divergence will follow. These divergences are the first in a series of divergences in human development that we can observe. Actually, the others occurred 500,000 years ago, several million years ago, in anatomic structure, in the functioning of the brain versus that of the animal brain, etc. But here we have one facet which will, of course, be unbelievably interesting to sociologists over a number of generations, and will have very strong macro-social repercussions on Earth, just as America had repercussions on Europe. I can't go into details here, I'm losing my sense of time. But now, the third point. Let me go to the moon. The moon as a whole versus other bodies. You know, some people used to say if God wanted man to fly, he would have given him wings. Now, we can say today, if God wanted a species such as this to become a spacefaring species, he would have given them a moon. So if we would have said... if you ever studied how we would have had to start if we would be living on Venus, with the nearest body being Earth. That's a heck of a problem. Here we have a body, first of all, which has a lower gravity. Just imagine, we had a neighbor that had six times the gravity. The astronauts would have collapsed after they got out of the module, and so forth. So, secondly, we have a body whose surface conditions are, with all acknowledgement of differences, far more similar to those of any other accessible surface, from Mercury to the moons of Saturn, then, and Mars, etc., than Earth is. So this is where we can cut our teeth on. to paraphrase that song, New York, New York, if you can do it there, you can do it anywhere, so to say, you know. And this is a technology. This gives us a chance to develop the technology, the science, the sociology that will make us fit to go further out into the solar system. Now, I don't want to say that, you know, we should wait, develop the moon for 100 years before we do anything beyond the moon. I don't mean that. But what I mean is that we have in the moon a proving ground, which, whether it is with problem areas over the next 25 or 30 years, or over the next 50, 60 years, is giving us the possibility right at our front door to test things out, to check things out, to live things through, to improve, to say, for sociologists, people can take so much of this, but they cannot take that. Now, if you do go on a long interplanetary mission, here is a body of experience. Here is a database that we have for you here. You see, we will develop the nuclear power plants with which we will operate on other worlds. We will develop the habitats. We will develop the ways of extracting the materials, etc. And this in itself is very important. And so the moon gives us here something in just 2 to 3 days distance that nothing else can give you. We even have practically the entire technology of getting there, getting back, because you don't need much more than oxygen, hydrogen, propulsion here, especially as soon as you are exploiting the lunar oxygen content. And for once, and that's something that's very close to my heart, even though I'm an engineer, I love to develop a new propulsion system or a new vehicle, but I also realize that we can't go on forever developing infrastructure. Some of these days, we've got to do something with it. And we are leading the world. We have the best transportation system now. One day we'll have the best space station. And then we will start working. Now, if we now concentrate on going to a planet, for example, then we would first definitely have to develop new propulsion systems. Because it doesn't make much sense to go to Mars on, you know, on by the skin of your teeth, getting there barely after, you know, 180 days or 150 days, and stay there for 8 days and rush off again for 200 days. Okay. There are better ways to do it if you want to do it chemically, and perhaps we will do it. But here we have the chance to take what we have and apply it. And we know already so much about the moon. We do know from our Apollo physiological experiences that, for example, the weight loss, and these are the data that came out, I summarized them here, that came out of Apollo flights, comparing the command module pilot, who was always in zero-G for the entire mission, with the two lunar crew members, one. The extremes are given here for the two members, or for the first and second member always. So the weight loss was 12 pounds. For zero-G, it was only plus minus 1 pound for the people who went down on the moon. The red blood cell mass went down very much less, 4% and 2% versus 9%. Plasma volume went down 10% versus 1% and 0%. Total body water went much more down in zero-G. Intracellular fluid went much more down. The work capacity, that means CO2 consumption and blood pressure, was significantly decreased in zero-G. There was no change in 1/6G. So that shows that 1/6G is already fine. You don't need 1G. It's very fine. Here, Senator Schmidt, the Apollo Lunar physiological experience, there was definitely, the astronaut agreed on positive therapeutic effects of moderate work in 1/6G. Capability of crew to sleep was varied with the individual because the conditions were very poor in the module. The metabolic rate and energy consumption was reduced on the lunar surface. Average walking speed on the moon was a respectable 2.3 mph in those relatively clumsy spacesuits and the heavy gear that they had to. Then it took a certain amount, 50 to 70% in the overall extremes, 20 to 100% longer to perform work, but the adaptation to perform faster was quick. Only the Apollo 15 crew took longer to return to normal and fell out of the general framework, and it's not still not yet clear exactly why. But the general consequence was favorable. Another thing that was often said was the moon is not so good because you have only one gravity level, one and one-sixth of a G, and some people doubted that the one-sixth is good. The one-sixth is okay. But in addition to this, the moon, the vacuum conditions on the moon, allow you to build large centrifuges, like this one. This is a 2,000-meter centrifuge here, and for prolonged stay, months of stay, in large environments at 1G, 0.4G in preparation for a Mars mission, for example, or rather here, I'm sorry, number two, this is 0.4G, or any other G level in between. And of course, it takes you only about 2 or 3% of the energy that it takes you from Earth to get into a circumlunar orbit. So you have everything from 1G down to 0G that you can have on the moon. So it is not true that you are really limited only to one gravity level. We have a fairly good idea of the material composition of the lunar surface. I'm sure everybody would agree we need to know more. But of course, we need a heck of a lot more. We know a heck of a lot more than what we used to know. And I have tried to put this here together, the amount of tonnage that has to be processed to get 1 ton of these elements. And of course, the major elements, oxygen, iron, silicon, and then calcium, and aluminum, magnesium, titanium, between 1 and 100 tons, lunar crude, you would have to process. And then sodium and chromium and manganese and sulfur and potassium, I've called minor elements, and then a number of borderline elements, phosphorus, zirconium, fluorine, nickel, etc., and carbon. The asterisk means selenogenic and cosmogenic abundance, so that means inputs from micrometeoroids. And of course, obviously, the pyramid it indicates that the plurality of the lunar element picture is poorer than that of Earth. But these are very important, technically very important elements. And we can be very glad that we have them here on the moon. Let me also say, when we later on come to the energy and come to underground detonation processing, the nice thing on the moon is that all those elements like strontium, etc., that give you long half-life isotopes don't exist on the moon. So if you blast an underground cavern nuclearly, you are not generating much radioactivity with all the neutron flux that's coming out of it. And the other thing is the abundance of oxygen, you know, which is 11% of water. If we had that kind of an abundance of hydrogen on the moon and practically extreme paucity of oxygen, as it is now of hydrogen, the lunar development would be immensely more expensive because we would have to bring over oxygen, which would, of course, be very, very expensive. So we know this. And although this is an overall picture, there are local variations, there are mineralogenic provinces, and there are different areas. For example, Tranquility Base was richer on minerals such as ilmenite carrying titanium than, for example, Apollo 15 or other landing sites. So there are mineralogenic provinces. So we have to explore and try to find those mineralogical provinces. Experiments of the agricultural variety, exoponic experiences with lunar ground, are also so far favorable. in their results. There hasn't been too much done, but what was done by NASA on Apollo 11 soil, by Russian tests on growing specimen of grain on lunar soil, all turned out to be very good. Now, one reason seems to be that the lunar soil is a little bit more reduced than the Earth soil. In other words, it is a little bit less oxygen saturated. And so the roots seem to have an easier time to get to iron, to manganese, to other elements that they want to have because they are not so fully oxidized. So we will be able to plan closed-loop lunar exoponic systems, either bacteria, plants, animals, humans, and waste, or from the waste to technical waste treatment itself. Now, another thing that we want to explore, of course, is whether there's ice on the moon. This is a picture of the lunar North Pole taken from one of the lunar orbiters. And of course, we don't know whether there's ice or not. My own analysis and those that I have seen anyway have not encouraged me very much to believe that there is ice. I say there are many reasons why there probably is none. Secondly, if there is ice, it is not clear that it is easily mineable or exploitable. It may be in the form of very thin layers covering many, many, many square miles. It may be more difficult and more expensive to retrieve that ice than to bring the hydrogen over because the oxygen you already have there. But it remains to be seen. I hope there is no ice, because if there is ice, especially in exploitable form, but in limited quantities, we'll probably have all environmental groups and the United Nations and the developing world and the Russians and us argue like in this Treaty of the Sea for the next 20 years. And Mike, we can forget about lunar development, because we will not be allowed to go on until this is clarified, you know. So I hope we don't fight any ice. It may be the easier thing to do. I realize that if there were large quantities of ice, it would be wonderful and easily exploitable. That would be great. But we'll have to see. So the philosophy right now, of course, that NASA is following and that I personally have also followed was assuming we don't have it. So if it turns out to be icing on the cake, literally speaking, then fine. Then it's so much that much easier. Another important thing is economically and also maybe physiologically, psychologically, we have to work at night on the moon. The lunar night is illuminated up to 100 times the full moon by Earth a part of the time. This is a picture from one of the landers near Tycho, I forgot the number now, but showing the sunset about 14 hours after sunset, and the planet Mercury up here a little bit blurred because the camera was fixed and Mercury was moving. And you see it's rather well lit. To work at night, you have to have an energy source that works at night, and there's only one that's nuclear. So now, just as the geosphere, so will the selenosphere have three fundamental subspheres, if you will, or spheres. The technosphere, into which falls all the technological and scientific development. The biosphere, into which falls, of course, the food production, all the environmental controls, the plants, the animals, etc., everything that is needed. And the sociosphere, that is the sphere of the human being, how he behaves, how the human population evolves. And of course, the industry is the bridge between the sociosphere and the technosphere, but in the modularized world of the moon, an easy bridge. Exoponics between technosphere and biosphere, and of course, the settlements cover everything, cover a combination of everything. That makes the development of settlements difficult. To get the right integration in the settlement itself, in the habitats, that's where you have a non-modularized integration. people, plants, and whatever technical things there are, such as trains, helicopters, or whatever else, machines that process the environment, the air and the water, those have all to be integrated to one thing, more or less within this habitat. And that, while one will take advantage of modularization where possible, it will be a problem, and we will have to learn. In a space colony, you will have to already lay out everything in advance. On the moon, in this more forgiving environment on the surface, where you have more alternatives, more spare and emergency facilities available, etc., you can gradually evolve systems, habitats, with their own climates to accommodate people from different parts of the Earth and learn from mistakes and gradually expand it. But, and here I want to come to a very important point, that as a human being, no matter how much we are engineers, as a human being, is a very important aspect. The moon offers us the earliest opportunity, not only for beneficial relevance of space activities for Earth, for the development of cislunar space, but the space between Earth and moon, but it is a large overriding task that taxes our imagination, our creativity, our maturity. We are the violent product of a violent evolution on a violent planet in a violent cosmos. We are right now going out into this universe with our heritage of the endless wars of hundreds of thousands of years and the tensions of our time, the ideological, sociological, demographic, religious, and whatever have you, hostilities and adversities frozen into us like the magnetic field of the sun is frozen into the solar wind as it moves out into space, away from the sun. And we go with all this heritage frozen into us. And it will stay with us. And if all we are doing, ultimately, is go from area bombing of Rotterdam, or Warsaw, or Dresden, or Hamburg, or Tokyo, to blowing up planets, what the heck is this all about? Why do we go out there in the first place? Why? What kind of creature is this then that's going out there? But if we have a large sociologically, macro-sociologically, deep, infusing and penetrating project. If we are aware that with our ability to get beyond this womb, out, with this ability, we are facing a new trade. The world builders, the builders of new worlds, a highly positive, combining and binding brotherhood furthering activity, then maybe that is a technology that helps us to grow and mature and let go of the terrible things. It is not in vain that all our nightmares are in the caves from whence we came, and all our hopes and all our shining deities are lying up there where we want to go. If we ultimately can make the transition, otherwise all technology is for naught. It'll be only used for what it be used before. And one can stand there and say, why go through all that effort? And the moon, you see, for that, an occasional scientific mission, important as they are, an exploratory mission, and I'm very much, very much forward for those, I cannot overemphasize that, is not enough. It isn't enough. It is something that has to grip more. And here is a possibility, perhaps, for the United States to lead the way on its side, those which agree with the United States ideals and way of living, Western Europe, Japan, and then whoever wants to join. Instead of quarreling now to whom the moon belongs, and plastered the solar system with forbidden signs all over already before we out there, and simulate the Treaty of Tordesillas, in which the Pope divided the world half Portuguese and half Spain, hang the natives, you know. This is historically atavistic. Let's go out there and be creative. The rest will find itself. Now, I'm not a lawyer. Maybe I'm speaking nonsense here, but the lawyers will have a field day. But I don't want to be stopped by that, personally. I think we should go and be creative. These people who will live here, these populations, will eventually anyhow become independent. I hope they can do it without big wars with us. But will anyhow become independent, because the oceans, being a common heritage of mankind, that is plausible. Mars, with its ferocious, beautiful wilderness, will be a mecca for artists, will be a mecca for tourists. Here, this will be a mecca for artists and tourists too. And so as the civilization grows, that positive component hopefully can be strengthened. And that is maybe the ultimate importance of the moon. Now, I have divided the development into five. And can we for a moment turn this off, if that's possible? Yeah. Into five development stages, very briefly. The first development stage assumes further prospecting with unmanned vehicles and orbiters. That, in my opinion, using shuttle, and Centaur J, for example, could be done in this decade. The second phase I see as the establishment of an orbiting operation center around the moon, as a cislunar or a circumlunar space station. Now, by that time, let's say in the 90s, hopefully, we could have already a so much experience with our near-Earth space station that the circumlunar space station can be done as a branch of this. From the circumlunar space station, small crews will occasionally go down, because I can see in development stage 2, in DS2, modules mailed directly from Earth to the surface, to a place which is likely to be the place of the first base, which would probably be established by the middle of development stage 2. And on that stage, on that location, which I will show also, we could have the first rather fully automated oxygen extraction plant. In my case, I have designed one that's using hydrogen and lunar dust, heating it up with induction heating to 2,000 or more degrees Kelvin, and getting about 50% to 60% oxygen out of it, and chilling it down in the form of water and electrolytically decomposing it, and then storing the oxygen. Now, the facility can be very simplified if you do not have a liquefaction facility right away with it, but operate with gaseous oxygen, not only for the people to breathe or to bring up to the circumlunar space station to breathe, but also as propellant. And this is a design of a lunar module that is using gaseous oxygen. Now, the smallest one is the most likely one. It has the oxygen at 200 degrees Kelvin at 4 atmosphere pressure, 10,000 kilograms. It's a 13.9 meter sphere with a human compartment here, with a freight compartment here, and hydrogen here. And this system would go and fill up. Here is a Füllstutzen, a GOX filling valve, fill up gaseous oxygen when it's down there, and that already would simplify the cost, or reduce the cost of the second stage very considerably, actually, at least the second half of the second stage. Now let's turn this off again, please. The third stage, then, is the first productive stage, a phase in which you have a lunar base industrial establishment, a central lunar processing facility. Now, this facility will at first produce oxygen, then it will produce, of course, also other materials. But there is probably no single location on the moon where you have all mineralogical provinces meet in immediate vicinity. Some may be a little bit further away. So in the fourth stage, I would envision the establishment of feeder stations in particularly valuable, perhaps still to be discovered, mineralogenic provinces, where there's a particularly strong content of ilmenite for titanium extraction, or for aluminum, or for sodium. Now these stations will, the more important ones of these stations, will eventually no doubt be connected by electromagnetic trains, 500, 700 kilometers per hour, maintaining the connections and bringing materials to the central processing facility. Because you don't want to have a processing facility at every mineralogenic province. That would be very unfavorable, and if market conditions shift, then some of these expensive bases would be out of work. You have one central station and you feed it what it needs. But initially, you won't have electromagnetic trains. And if you don't have those, ballistic delivery suggests itself. Now let's say the distant feeder station is here. The central processing facility, which has the generic name Cynthia here, because it also includes the landing strip, the takeoff facilities, everything. So it's really more than just the industrial processing facility. Now there will be some stations that will be rather close, let's say less than 120 miles from Cynthia, and there you could have on hanging rails electrically bilinear motor driven cars which are being loaded there with the minerals. Same way here, but let's say if you're 1,000 kilometers away or 500-600 kilometers away, it's quite a distance, and you can hurl this over into pre-set receiving stations. Since we are already on the Earth, can now knock each other's silos out, it will be no problem to hit within meters accuracy something on the moon where you have no movement of the plates and no weather, no wind, no nothing. And so this delivery. Now the connection between the center, Cynthia, and this outside feeder station is via laser, high data transmission laser over a communication station, which you don't want to build because it may have to be 20 or 30 kilometers high to maintain the connection. But you don't want to have it as a satellite either. It's a bother because it isn't there all the time because of precession, etc. But what you can do on the moon, where everything weighs only 1/6, you can float this on a microwave beam like a ping pong ball on a water jet. And now you can have it any height that you have a vacuum. You can have it in 10 kilometers, in 5, can have it in 100 kilometers, makes no difference. And so if you have it near Cynthia, in the ballistic case, it has to be very high. Later on, where you have electric transmission all the way because you have an electromagnetic train, you can have it in the middle, for example, and then it can be lower, although it doesn't make that much difference. And that turns out to be an extremely practical way of communicating any way you want to on the moon. And again, the lunar environment is very conducive and helpful in that respect. Now, the transmission system, the launch system for the ballistic transmission, I've looked at a large number of systems, electromagnetic system, this and then the other thing. One system that impresses me as being very suitable is a centrifugal launcher. Now you can have a centrifugal launcher with radial launch tubes, as indicated by those two here, and to some extent by this, yeah. Then you launch with a velocity that's equal to the circumferential velocity. If you have a curved launch tube, one that launches tangentially, this does not, this launches at about 50 degrees, but let's say tangentially, then your launch velocity is twice your circumferential velocity, which is of course very favorable. You don't have to rotate so fast. This gives you very long launch tubes, and this may not be the overall bottom line optimum. 50 degrees gives you already 1.8 times the circumferential velocity. That would give you a line like this, and this would be constructed this way with a supporting structure like this. He's seen from the side, so to say, and he's seen from above. The system runs on magnetic cushions propelled by electromagnetic, by linear motors. And to give you an idea of some design data on this, as you see, the linear motor drive can be, again, doesn't have to be at the periphery. It can be a little bit further inside, which reduces its velocity still more. If you have, for example, 50 meters axial tube lengths, and you want to have a ballistic range of 750 kilometers, then you need a launch angle of 35 degrees. You see, this is fixed, or this launcher would stay at a particular mineralogenic province and launch to Cynthia, which wouldn't change its distance. So that angle can be fixed. And it would go, let's say, radial, like this. Then you would have to, you would need a launch speed of 1,000 meters per second. Now, if you do this straight, then you would have to have a circumferential speed of 1,000 meters. If you do this in this curved launch tubes, you would have a launch speed of 1,000 divided by 1.8, which means your circumferential velocity can be down to 555 meters per second. And the linear motor drives here can be down, since they are at 70% of the distance from center to circumference, about 392. Meters per second. That would be 1,411 kilometers per hour, 875 miles per hour. So it's still quite a velocity, but it makes it possible to hurl over these distances. And there are many advantages to this particular system. It is automated most easily, etc. I can't go into details here right now. Just give you an idea. Now, there are three key factors that we have to develop to make the moon development economically viable and feasible. We have to make some breakthroughs in the transportation sector, we have to address the energy sector, and we have to address the task of utilizing lunar materials for as much as possible, not only construction, but for cooling, for braking. And I've used here the word harenodynamic from harenosus, that means the sandy. And that's the Latin for sandy, and our word arena comes from that. Harenodynamic cooling, harenodynamic braking, and of course construction. Now, in the transportation sector, having the five development sections, and I was amiss to mention the fifth one. The fifth one is the large one where you have Selenopolis, where you have a fully developed lunar population and under an industry underwriting it, a fully developed lunar world, a selenosphere. You have made the full transition from the moon as we know it today to the selenosphere as the people in the middle of the next century will know it. And we have, of course, over those five development stages, we have Earth to near-Earth orbit, cislunar space, and lunar space development. And you see in each one of these particular developments occur. I believe we can begin with the shuttle and with Centaur, and that's perfectly fine. There may be some capture retrothrust units for the automated lander. The operated shuttle, with this I mean the HLLV, where we have, instead of the orbiter, a large payload capsule with only reusable or retrievable propulsion system engines. But a special emphasis on the lunar ferry with lunar liquid oxygen, lunar slide lander, and partly enclosed launch track. Some new developments here, and then later on developments here and here. Now again, obviously I cannot go through all of these in detail, but I want to make some main points. The transition from the gaseous lunar ferry to the liquid lunar ferry is shown here. This is for one that lands and takes off with essentially the same amount of payload. This is one that is for exports. In other words, it comes down with little payload, And those propellant tanks here for heavy payload takeoff. And this one here for import, for landing large facilities with large tanks for descent and lighter tanks for ascent. Basically, one particular configuration can handle all three things. But this system has this one advantage, even if it's with lunar oxygen. It has to bring up the lunar oxygen back to the circumlunar orbit that it needs for the next descent. And that cuts deeply into the payload capacity, especially the export payload capacity, because it has to do this. So it is nice, it would be nice to have a system that doesn't need any or very little propellant to land. And that is the lunar slide lander, a system that uses a flat portion of the lunar surface covered with lunar dust to transfer the momentum of the incoming spaceship to the lunar sand. Now the runway would be prepared by removing the somewhat larger rocks that may be in there to a depth of 30 centimeters, maximal probably 50 centimeters. Because according to my calculations, the breaking surfaces of the lunar slide lander go only down a few centimeters. And to smooth out any unevennesses that are there. Again, the details of the landing dynamics would take another 1 hour talk, so I will not go into this one here. The descent of such a lunar slide lander would look as follows. From the low Earth, or low near moon space station orbit, the lunar slide lander would leave shortly after passing over the crater Mendeleev on the other side of the moon. Let's say if you wanted to land in the far western Oceanus Procellarum, then it would come down, make a mid-course correction, very close to a perilune, would adjust the flight path so that it comes down in a gliding path at the western end of Oceanus Procellarum. The system is shown here in these two pictures. It will have, if it decelerates with an average deceleration of 4G, will have approximately an 80 kilometer long runway. It does need some supporting thrust, which replaces the aerodynamic lift of a landing aircraft. It comes down with the aft fin first, and then sets down in a very controlled manner with the braking surfaces. The braking surfaces throw the sand, at first I had them throw the sand up vertically, there being no wind, and the radiation pressure providing only very little displacement, it would come right back down here again. But I found that it would interfere with the space station. And so the dust would go up too high. So the dust is now being thrown up and forward, and then up, and then it doesn't go that high, and comes down on the landing strip. The system consists of, that's upside down, but okay. You can see that that's the aft fin, that's the braking surface. The system comes in here, that's the surface. That's a support to prevent oscillations. The crew, this is the pressurized compartment, this is the unpressurized compartment. And these are the supporting thrusters that determine the angle of attack of the system. You see, the design is very nice. You have no aerodynamic heating. The system can be designed for cold flight. You have no communications blackout, you have no ionospheric problems, you have excellent visibility, no weather problems. The only critical area are the braking surfaces. The best material seems to be lunar aluminum oxide, Al2O3, doped with zirconium dioxide. The German Max Planck Institute for Material Research, Dr. Niels Clausen has developed a doping method with zirconium dioxide, which goes into different martensitic modes as function of temperature to create a cracking effect of thousands of hairline cracks, which give a normally heavy cracking ceramic the toughness characteristics of a high temperature metal. And that is the answer for what's here required. The temperature shock the mechanical shock, the friction shock, and possibly the chemical shock. If in the hot boundary layer of the dust that's coming, that's being thrown up here, the oxygen is being released out of the lunar material. There will be tests that have to be run, of course, and so forth. The test program I've worked out on this. Now, to take off, the normal takeoff, the conventional takeoff, of course, is the Apollo one. Then the one most considered among the advanced ones is the electromagnetic takeoff. But this requires a very extensive structure. It requires a very accurate structure. And it, unless it is to become very long, it would also require very high G loads and an enormous power input during the acceleration phase of millions of kilowatt seconds. In other words, you either have to have large storage devices or you have to have huge power plants which let go at one moment and then accelerate the thing. Now, there's one other way. You can develop a tube in which there is a chemical catapult. This chemical catapult is connected with a payload platform outside, so you have plenty of space to get odd-shaped payloads on there and still keep the tube small by a dorsal fin. The chemical catapult hangs on that dorsal fin. The dorsal fin hangs on the payload platform. The payload platform runs on magnetic cushions, so it has no material contact. The chemical catapult, which can have four engines or possibly less, accelerates the system to release speed. This one is released, and it's done electromagnetically, subsequently slowed down, and comes back. Now, the maximum speed with which this system has to reach to release this and get into a slightly elliptical orbit to an upper lune where it then can be circularized and then meet with the space station is at the most about 1,750 meters per second. That's a little bit more than 6,800 or so feet per second. Now, the exhaust velocity is in the order of over 4,000 meters per second. So the gases are being automatically collected at the beginning of the tube. The gases are water. If we don't burn stoichiometrically, which I hope we would, but if there is a hydrogen excess, then this hydrogen excess is burned by oxygen being blasted out at the rear of the ship. So you have only water. The water is easily condensed by cold oxygen at the beginning of the tube. And now you have water. Either you can use this as water, and for a 40-ton launch payload, you have about 1.5 hydrogen. So you have something of the order of 7 tons water. That's beautiful. You can either use that in your facility, in which case the propellant performs double duty, or you can electrolytically, within a week, easily decompose it again to oxygen, hydrogen, and use it again and again and again. The losses are in the order of 1% or 0.5%. So your de facto supply-specific impulse is in the order of 30 to 40,000 seconds. You don't even have a nuclear ship that does that, except for a nuclear pulse of a very advanced kind, or a mirror fusion system. So, and you do not overload your electrical system. And you can be a little bit longer. It's about 20 kilometers long, the system. Now, if we have those two systems, that means going down, slide landing, and then going back up by means of the partially closed launch track, partially enclosed launch track that you just saw, then the total velocity that we need to get from Earth to Moon and back, Earth to near-Earth orbit, that costs you a lot. Of course, that's very expensive. Then getting injection into translunar orbit, then capture on the Moon, then conventional landing, conventional takeoff, and conventional re-injection into trans-Earth orbit, and then Hohmann braking maneuver, it means aerodynamic braking maneuver here. But instead of conventional landing, on conventional takeoff, slide lander landing, and slide lander takeoff, then conventional re-injection to trans-Earth orbit, and Hohmann braking maneuver here. You see that if you compare this red line now with this line, which gives you the velocity profile to a libration point, L4 or L5. Then you can see that you practically have eliminated the lunar gravitational field as a cost factor. Your velocity is practically the same as what you have to bring up if you go to L4 or L5. So the moon, you have all the help from the gravity, but you eliminate all the cost factors caused by the gravity if you do the slide lander and the partially enclosed launch strike. Now, the interorbital transfer vehicles have to be laid out for home and braking maneuvers and also modularized to take various shapes, to carry loads of various size over there and operate with, those do not operate with home and braking maneuver. This one does. Those do not. Those operate already with lunar filling stations in geosynchronous orbit, in near-Earth orbit. And because of the advanced time, I will jump over the next two slides and will not go into those. They're very interesting, but they are not that important. That's an oxygen tanker. The transport capacities and so forth are calculated, and there's some very interesting things which show one thing, maybe one key result out of all of these investigations I ought to mention, should mention. You can, if you now forget about the lunar excess with a slide lander and with the partially enclosed launch track, and you look at the other two areas, Earth to near-Earth orbit and cislunar. That means from near-Earth orbit from near-Earth orbit all the way over to the moon. Then you can try to get the cost down in surface to near-Earth orbit or near-Earth orbit in cislunar. And it turns out that your biggest returns are in near-Earth orbit to cislunar. This is where your big savings, where your big economy is coming in, because it is expensive. These are the ships for the outer cislunar space. I will not go into this. But perhaps I can dwell for just a minute here. Because if you are comparing now the amount of propellant you have to expend per unit mass of payload, in other words, tons of propellant that you have to bring into near-Earth orbit or have to load per ton of payload, then you can see here, and this shows you values between 10 and 100 tons of propellant per ton of payload. And you see that the launch vehicles are lying all in this area. That's the shuttle. These are the two HLLVs, one with solid core boosters and the other one with oxygen-hydrogen boosters, and then some other advanced launch vehicles. They're all lying up here, and there's not much you can do. It just costs you almost 9,000 meters per second to get into near-Earth orbit. You have to burn a lot of propellant off there. Already with Centaur, you are now entering the 10-to-1 pound per pound of payload or per ton of payload consumption. And with the cislunar modules that I showed you just a moment ago, you are lying here as far as oxygen and hydrogen is concerned. If you only have to bring up hydrogen, because the oxygen is fueled, is tanked in filling stations in near-Earth orbit and geosynchronous orbit, then you are down here in the fraction of 1/10 to 1 pound of consumables per pound of payload. That's where your big savings lie. And if the supply from Earth is down to these low levels, then you can use, let's say, shuttle derivatives. You do not have to go to an extremely large new launch vehicle, although if you have enough payload, it would pay off. But if you do not have enough payload, if most of your payload consists of consumables for the subsequent legs of the mission, then the reduction in consumables here is reflected in the reduction of launches here, and that is what reduces your overall cost tremendously. Now, to go one step further into the outer cislunar space and into the lunar space itself, the outer cislunar space with magnetoplasma dynamic ships or ion ships between 48 and 24-hour orbit and circumlunar orbit, there you lie also between 1/100 and 1/10 of a pound per pound of payload or ton per ton of payload. Resupply from Earth. And with the slide lander, here, and the partially enclosed launch track here, you see you're even approaching 1/1000th of a ton. That means 1 kilogram consumption from consumables from Earth per ton of payload transported. Now you're talking, economically speaking. Now, again, very briefly, the energy situation. What counts, basically, as far as your transportation requirements is concerned, because solar and nuclear can run for long times without much attendance and maintenance, et cetera, et cetera. Maybe I would think the nuclear more than the solar, because there's lunar dust to consider, et cetera. The nuclear doesn't care about it. An advanced photovoltaic system has approximately 150 kilowatt electric per ton. Delivers approximately 150 kilowatt electric per ton. That is without any storage devices. Just put it in the sun as you do it in space orbit, and let it do. A solar focusing system with a Brayton, no, I'm sorry, not with a Brayton, with an MHD converter is about 200 kilowatt electric per ton. Most of the nuclear reactors are way higher. And obviously, the more kilowatt per ton, the better. Only the smaller ones are lying here, below that level. But that is a level that you reach if you don't have to store. That means you have to shut everything down during every 14 days for 14 days. That doesn't make any sense economically. In fact, it doesn't make you economically viable. It isn't possible. If you want to store, then your weight goes up. That means the kilowatt electric delivered per ton that has to come from Earth goes down like this. Now, with a fuel cell, you get about 2,000 kilowatt hours electric per ton of fuel cell. 2,000 kilowatt hour electric. And that is this line here. This line shows how your kilowatt hour electric goes down that you can get per ton delivered from Earth, depending on what fraction of the daylight consumption you want in the nightlight consumption. So one here means you consume as much during the night as you consume during the day. 0.5 means you consume half as much. 0 means you consume nothing during the night. Then you get, of course, the full value here or here. But if you would use fuel cells, then even if you had 50%, look here down here, you're way below even the smallest molybdenum uranium dioxide reactor, which is this one here. So, and now I have looked at it. I wanted to give the solar a chance. I have looked at using lunar sand as a storage material. And with that, you might be able to get 20,000 kilowatt hours per ton delivered from Earth, because so much is lunar sand, doesn't have to be delivered from Earth. Now that is the 20,000 line here. It also falls, with the exception of the smallest reactor, falls below all the other reactors. You can't do it. The only way where I feel that the solar energy is really useful is as high temperature to generate very high processing heat. Because the processing heat of all these reactors here, the molten salt reactor, all these more advanced ones, even the high temperature reactor, the pebble bed reactor, which is around 1,000 degrees Kelvin, is not as good as what you can achieve by concentrating solar radiation. You are then bound by the lunar day, and you can forget that one only if you go into the plasma reactors with 5,000 to 25,000 degrees operating temperatures. Now then you're up here, and they are not immediately available, of course. So while you're down here, the thing to do is to have nuclear reactors and solar for processing heat. Even if you are assuming that you have a solar power plant in L4 and are beaming megawatts of power laser-wise
over to the moon for day and night supply. You're lying at about 100 kilowatt electric per ton to be delivered from Earth, and you have a considerable maintenance problem here at L4. It can't touch the lunar system. They are really the best. So therefore, on the energy perspective, the early ones in development stage 1, 2, and 3 are the molybdenum, UO2, that should be seen, UO2, 100 kilowatt thermoelectric reactors with about 100 kilowatt electric and with 2 tons transparency weight and 4 to 7 years service life unattended. Then for the advanced Cynthia and feeder stations, the next one is really the breeder reactor, uranium-233, not 235, no plutonium-239, helium-bladen, hydrodynamic cooling, that is, sand is being used to cool, which reduces the total transportation weight enormously, since you have no radiation coolers, and you can work down to very low temperatures, because if you are using cryogenic temperature lunar sand, the T^4 law doesn't go off, the radiation cooler doesn't apply anymore, so it can be much smaller, much lighter. And lunar sand shielding, I'll show this in a moment. And here, for electrical outputs of 4 to thermal is 212 and 50, electrical to 72 and 500 megawatts. The transportation weights are 264 and 974 tons. Later on, in conjunction with Cynthia, two underground detonation. Typically, that's a little bit advanced. There are earlier caverns that are not quite as big, 100,000 cubic meters, 57 meters diameter, in 1,000 meter steps, and it produces about, recovers about 26.5 tons per 0.1 kiloton, that is 10 to the 8 kilocalories. That's extremely interesting, the use of underground facilities, but again, unfortunately, I can't go into this one. Now, later on, fusion. Now, the first, the molybdenum uranium-02 reactor, would be flown over from the Earth, cold, not started, of course, in a landing configuration, which you see here. These are the landing power plants, the landing engines. This is the reactor here. This is the lithium shield. These are the shadow shield configuration. This is the, these are the legs. After it has landed, it will be surrounded by a wall of lunar sand. This is the shadow shield. The lunar sand shields in every other direction. Then it's connected with the loads and it started up. The thing from top looks like this. It has these landing legs, and then it has legs that are being set up, a double wall system that can be rolled in two parts. It's one part, two parts, and three parts. It can be rolled in, and the connecting walls are supporting now those little legs. And while, when they are all in, they are filled with lunar sand. So you don't have to dig, you don't have to do anything, but really only roll those on, and then have a mobile conveyor belt which just fills it up with sand to the required point to provide the necessary shielding. Now the breeder reactors are a little bit different. Designed. There's down here a breeder reactor in a hole. This is the surface area here. In a hole, the heating of the gas takes place here, goes back to a turbo generator facility through the hydrodynamic cooling. This is a turbo generator facility seen from top. These are the hydrodynamic cooling lines here, and then it comes back in here. The fuel processing and breeding material extraction facility lies here on the surface, and cranes are handling everything. And this is again lunar sand to shield it. It's basically a relatively simple facility which can work pretty much unattended and remote control for years on end. Now, the best reactor, incidentally, of the various types, I've investigated the high temperature reactor, the molten salt reactor, the colloid core reactor, the Norbert type reactor is the uranium hexafluoride reactor. It can be used as, it has a very excellent neutron economy. It consumes only a few hundred kilograms of fuel per year, which is a cinch supply-wise. It has very, because of its excellent neutron economy, it has very low breeder doubling times of 1.9 to 2.1 years. So very quickly, it can feed new or stock up new reactors. And it works for years, practically unattended. It has a very small and comparatively simple fuel processing facility. And it is the first logical step in the direction of plasma reactors, a very high temperature reactor. And I show you here, that's more futuristic, a light bulb plasma reactor with up to 25,000 degrees Kelvin operating temperature. It gasifies and ionizes lunar sand, and then by fractional cooling, by helium, cold helium surface, it cools it down to the temperature of titanium and iron and silicon, etc., etc., which are then collected. And this produces tons of these materials per day. But this is not a near term, obviously. Here is another one with a plasma reactor or a light bulb reactor driving a hot gas for a blast furnace, which is continually, periodically, intervals being filled up with lunar rock and small dust, small stones and material, and is melted and then subsequently directed through an electrolytic facility. I am not so sure how well those magma electrolytic facilities will work out. Therefore, if you do go into underground detonation facilities and you fill the cavern with hydrogen and you detonate, you have your nuclear charge, which is shown in detail here. That's a fission igniter with a fusion charge, DT fusion charge. You hang this magnetically here, and after the gas is in, and after lunar dust is in, and again the 1/6 G comes to your aid here, nothing settles very fast. Then you release the charge, it drops within 10, 15 seconds to the center, and that's being detonated. And you are generating large amount of oxygen, which connects with hydrogen into water, into steam, and the steam is being brought up to the surfaces then. Either it produces the steam and then electrolytically decomposed after it's chilled down as water. The efficiency can be increased by not distributing the dust in the cavern, but by actually compiling the dust around the charge. Then most of the energy, which is generally 10 to the 8 to 10 to the 9 calories, that means 0.1 kiloton to 1 kiloton, goes directly first into the solid material, evaporates it. You get a whole range of mixing ratios between it that rides then the shock waves outward and the hydrogen, which is being heated in the process. And thereby you get those efficiencies that I mentioned earlier on this chart, namely about 26 tons of oxygen per 0.1 kiloton charge. And it turns now out, when I was all through, I found that I could actually, while I had to detonate the caverns by nuclear materials, which could be uranium-233 as igniter, as fission igniter, and then very clean deuterium-deuterium or deuterium-tritium detonation, that the detonation itself, if it's small, a small unit was 10 to the 7th kilocalories release, could be done by using oxygen hydrogen instead of a nuclear charge. So I would only have to bring in the hydrogen, the oxygen comes from the moon, and I got detonate, then have a chemical detonation plant, not a nuclear one. That's a possibility. But I don't think we should be afraid of the nuclear. That's part of our maturing to help. And incidentally, it does not violate the space treaty, which clearly says only weapons. You can use nuclear material you have to announce it, et cetera, et cetera. And using uranium-233, which is not nuclear bomb material, staying away from 235 and plutonium-239, this could be very nicely resolved. The igniters of the detonation units here are very small. They're 1 kiloton, 2 kiloton units, except for blasting with the caverns. There you can have to go up to 50, 60 kilotons at 1,000 meters depth. But that's a single time. We don't have to do that again then. The cavern is there forever. You can also use this for breeding, and there are special unit charges designed for breeding where you have a deuterium tritium fast neutron release. You have beryllium-9, which gives you an additional neutron. It has an N2N reaction with minus 1.67 million electron volts. So it gives a very weak shock, but a very intense neutron stream, which then goes through 7 Li, lithium-7, where it's converted to tritium by fast neutrons, and into 6 lithium enriched material, where it's converted to tritium by slow neutrons. And then similarly, you can design for uranium-233 breeding out of thorium-232. And these are much more efficient than the nuclear power plant breeders. Once you have those caverns, you can do that. And then, of course, the non-plus ultra will be fusion power plants, which are easier to build on the moon because you have a very high vacuum, 10 to the minus 10 torr, whereas here it costs you an arm and leg to get and maintain 10 to the minus 6 torr. You can have the walls much farther away. You can have much larger volumes. Therefore, the load, the neutron burning load in a DT reaction is very much reduced. Right now, you have about 10 to the 22 high-speed, high-energy neutrons per square centimeter per second hitting the walls of a terrestrial DT power plant. And that means that the walls are pretty much shut up after about 1 year. This would not be the case on the moon. There are several other things, such as maintaining cryogenic magnets, etc., which is much easier on the moon itself. I will go over the industrial perspective here now, but want to show that if you take all the considerations into account, especially the landing and takeoff, etc., what affects your industrial facility, your Cynthia, most of all, one of the best places is the Western Oceanus Procellarum. To orient you, here is Kepler, here is Grimaldi, here is Sibelius, here is Lohrmann, and here is the crater Lohrmann A. Here is Rainer Gamma and Planitia Descensus, which is where Lunar 9, the first successful Russian lunar landing took place in this small mountain range here, Planitia Descensus. So I took the audacity, and I apologize to all astronomers and lunar researchers and so forth for the impertinence to name something, but I named this little mountain range here Planitia Cynthia because it lies right at the end of a very ideal landing strip, which I called Portus Diana. And this is a 100 kilometer long strip from here to here. And this is very, very smooth, to the best to which, the best shot that I could find in searching NASA records and so forth. Do you see this here enlarged? This is Hevelius. This is the north part of Grimaldi. This is Lohrmann. This is crater Lohrmann A. This is Planitia Cynthia. And these are the 100 kilometers of Portus Diana. And they're very, very smooth. And it should be possible to establish an 80 or 60 kilometer long runway there. And also, a partially enclosed launch track, which then takes off in this direction. With certain feeder stations, the lunar industrial zone would comprise, with Cynthia here, would comprise about this area. Okay, I'd be almost through. Now, I will not go into the market perspective. I personally believe that among the large customers will be many facilities in near-Earth orbits, hospitals, hotels, small cities, research stations, factories, etc., and a very large reflector facility. Again, I can't talk about the benefits and prospects of this, and not about this one either. But just one closing word about the buildings on the moon. I think the systems that will be mailed from Earth directly might look somewhat like this. This is a cargo bay here. This is a two-story test and technical research facility with the windows directed downward so as to be safe from micrometeorites. And here is a high albedo layer laid out to reflect sunlight into it. These are designs made out of lunar bricks for hothouse configurations and human habitats. This is Cynthia in a slightly more advanced stage. This is Lohrmann A, the crater. These are the mountains that eventually lead to Lohrmann C. These are the northern mountains of Planitia Cynthia. This is the runway for the lunar slide lander. That is the partially enclosed launch track. Here are the thermoelectric molybdenum uranium O2 power plants, the lunar material built facilities, the mining facilities, and the processing facility. So I believe that once this is done, we will gradually expand our facility range. And we will have larger habitats, several hundred feet high, several hundred feet wide, with different climatic conditions, as indicated by those colors. I know there's at least one Berliner here, my old friend Herman, and you might recognize that just for the heck of it, I used the Berlin subway net as a guide. Maybe I should have used the Washington, but I didn't have a plan until I arrived here. But I did have one of my hometown. So this is these are various subway lines. And so one could imagine a facility system like this where you try various things out to go to larger facilities, which eventually, with their supporting fusion power plants and other power plants, might look like this. I can't go into the details of the architecture and the illumination. There are many, many very interesting ways of lunar architecture, which I have illustrations, which I all took out this afternoon, full of fear. And that's right, I couldn't have shown it anyway. This is the interior with a continental climate during the summertime, sort of, now this is a little bit the lighter side, continental climate to wintertime, with the hall of the lunar astronauts here. And you see here a nodal point, one of the nodal points, with all the climatic maintenance facilities. And here you look through to a tropical segment, to a completely different climate. And this is a Mediterranean climate, sort of. So now, the final system between Cynthia, which will be the large industrial town, the Pittsburgh of the moon, so to say, or whatever. Maybe I shouldn't say that now anymore, but anyway. The area which I found can be illuminated, because don't forget, it costs an enormous amount of electrical energy to illuminate hectares and hectares of land, or acres and acres of land, to grow food and grow plants, etc., and animals. And you can do this, of course, much better if you apply the reflector principle, the mirror principle, to the moon too. Now, you can't go you can't go to L4 or L5. That's too far away. And you do have not enough material to do this, and this is not realistic. But what you can do is you can go to L1. L1 is approximately 54,000 kilometers above the lunar surface. Now, L1 is not a stable libration point, but neither, strictly speaking, is L4 and L5 in the four-body system. Earth, Moon, Station in L4, L5, and Sun. The sun is a perturbing factor you have to correct out there too. So in L1 you have to control, you have to navigate around L1. But if you do illuminate from L1 to a brightness of about 0.6 solar constant of space, the solar constant of space is 1.3 times the Earth constant of space. So you're talking still about 0.8 Earth constants there. Then you need about 120,000 square kilometers reflector surface, and they illuminate about 200,000 square kilometers here. That is the equivalent of 264,200 fusion power plants of 1.2 gigawatts each. Well, it's a tremendously powerful illumination system by reflectors whose individual elements look like Venetian blinds, covered with sodium layer from the moon, 99% reflectivity. Each one of these is in here. That is a 100 by 100 kilometer unit. And this is the back, this is the side. And this illuminates now during the night, this area that you saw there just a moment ago, it'll go in yellow, in the center of the moon around Sinus Medii. And here, this is a picture that shows the connection between Nova Terra with all its greenhouses and its communication facilities. Here, in eternal light, only for 1 hour per month do the reflectors pass through the shadow of the moon. Now that's nothing. And you see here the 120,000 square kilometers, which in 54,000 kilometer distance have about the same angular diameter as the Earth. Beneath it, the full Earth behind it, you see the gossamer configuration of the reflectors here, and you see an electromagnetic train making the connections in 4 hours, if it runs 500 kilometers per hour, between Nova Terra and Cynthia. But in between lie the various facilities of Selenopolis. Now this system then can be said to be essentially totally developed, and in the year 2062, one after the next return of Halley's Comet, we may, the flyer in geolunar space approaching moon here along its orbit, this is Mare Orientale here, so you surveying the moon and Earth, might see in L1 the reflector facility. It might see here the part of the reflected area, and in an orbit over it, the construction of huge interplanetary space ships, space facilities. Cynthia lights over here, and Selenopolis lights all along the axis Nova Terra, Cynthia. And now we have practically fully developed our double planet system. We are already long on our way to Mars, of course. But we may prepare to get on our way into the outer solar system, because just as the moon is a proving ground for Mars, Mercury, asteroids, etc., so the outer solar system is probably the proving ground for interstellar flights. The disappearance of Earth, the near disappearance of the sun, the immense loneliness, emptiness, coldness, darkness of outer solar system is, if you can do it there, you cannot do it in interstellar space. But I don't believe that anybody just getting from here, being an urban Earth or moon inhabitant, and go out into interstellar space, you probably go crazy. So the psychological foundations are not laid, the infrastructure of operating for years and centuries are not laid, but they will be laid with systems that will be built near the moon and will be flown into the outer solar system. So the moon is, in that sense, not only the jumping board into the solar system, into the magnificent heritage of our sun, but also into the cosmos itself. Now, if we have all those perspectives, and if we start here with this overriding creative thing, and in all sincere humbleness, I mean, this is one guy thinking, there's all this brain power out here to whom I talk, and those who are not here, who will come up with additional ideas, better ideas, more ideas. If we can infuse this, if we can make this a historical goal, for the future of mankind, literally, for the growth of mankind, and for the betterment and improvement of life on Earth, with all the things that we can do in this lunar space, then I can't think personally of anything that is more oriented toward a healthy mankind, more oriented to building other worlds, not so we have a world in case we've blown this one up, but to build other worlds in order that this may never be blown up, may be greened again, and may become again the wonderful acropolis of life that it was, once was, that now is in conflict with us to some degree, if we look at the dying off of species, etc., and that it can be again because of our information metabolism and our creativity that we can do and our growing maturity. Thank you very, very much.
I didn't mention before, but I'm sure you appreciated through the talk that Dr. Ehricke's own artwork was shown time and time again throughout the talk, and that reflects what BJ said before, that he is a unique combination of scientist, engineer, and artist, and we thank you for that also. One additional thing before we close is Krafft's book, the title of which is
The Seventh Continent, the Industrialization and Settlement of the World.
All right, will appear next year, and we should all be looking forward to that. Thank you again, Krafft, for a very interesting and just a wonderful start for some of the things that we have started to imagine, but you've been thinking of for a long time. Thank you.